Welcome back to Unfiltered Kitchen. We're back with another episode, which is going to be part two of
boom, 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 boom,
week's episode, because we did not get through a lot of the questions that you guys sent us, honestly.
Part two.
Yeah.
Do you guys realize Boz is 2 years old now?
No, Dad, that's Zaire.
Zaire
is two.
Zaire is two, yeah. I'm sorry.
Boz is four, and he looks like he's like six. Seven.
Yeah, yeah. Boz is going to be a great big kid.
Boz is going to be huge.
Yeah. Yeah. He's not going to be huge.
He's going to be tall and skinny.
He's going to be a good size.
He's going to be tall. He's as big
as
Ryder. He's
not going to be like 6'5 tall. He's
Why not?
I don't think so.
He has tall parents.
We'll see. But anyway, what I was trying to say. Zaire, 2 years old. Does it seem like he's been around? It seemed like he's been around a lot longer.
It does.
Yeah. Me too.
Well, Ace is two. Does he seem like he's been here for 2 years?
It's not his birthday. We're talking about Zaire.
It's not Zaire's birthday anymore either.
But what do you mean? We just celebrated Zaire's birthday.
His birthday was like a week ago, though. We just celebrated.
You should post the pictures of Zaire and Boz in the wedding.
Okay, so what it is my sister's son is Zaire, if you guys don't know. He just turned two, but he celebrated his birthday was actually his uncle's wedding. So Zaire's dad, Mezier, his brother got married back in Maryland on Zaire's birthday, which is October 28th. And they're Nigerian, so they had a big African wedding. They had outfit changes. I think they had an outfit that was like Nigerian, and then I think they changed into an outfit that was more from, I want to say Ghana. I think.
Is that the red one?
I think the red one was the, how do you say it? Ghanaian?
Ghanaian? Yeah, I don't know.
Okay, the red outfit is from the Ghana place, and the yellowish outfit was from their, like, Nigerian roots. So it was pretty really cool. Nice, Mezier was sending us pictures and videos back, you know, while they were at the wedding. We got to see the boys all dressed up and the dances and the money dance and different things that we just don't, you know, we don't have necessarily.
Can I tell you a funny story about a money dance?
Yeah.
I mean, it's not really funny.
Yeah.
It's kind of funny. It's funny to me.
Okay, you know, let's hear it.
So when we went to Sean and Jade's wedding.
Okay.
Remember, they shot the money gun or something.
Yeah.
Right? Mm-hmm. And it was in a certain area of the ballroom.
Okay, so during the entrance, when they had the bridesmaids come in, the groomsmen come in, then, you know, the bride and groom come in. That's what he's talking about. There was some money guns being shot during that time.
Right, right. So later on, I was somewhere. Well, first, I need to tell you the story, backstory.
Okay.
This is years, long, long, long time ago, when I was a young man, when $100 really made a difference to me.
Okay.
I mean, still does, but, you know, this is when I'm really young and it really meant. I had dropped $100 in some 20s, something like that. Somebody stopped me and said, hey, sir, mister, hey, bro, you dropped this. And I mean, this is back when $100 just meant a lot.
Yeah.
Okay. So I've always had the intention of returning that one day. Somebody drops money, you know,
You wanted to give it back.
I want to give it back.
Okay.
So that's the backstory.
I think I know where this story is going?
So we're at the wedding, and I look down, there's $100 bill. Mm-hmm. First thing I did, I swooped it up. And then I started thinking about what I've always wanted to do, find the owner of money that dropped. So now I'm looking around. Who's close? Who could have dropped it?
Okay.
Who could have dropped the money? I see one guy. Hey, did you drop? No, he didn't drop. He looks like he's full of money. He don't need it. So I take it. And for all I've been trying to do for 15, 20 years, return, I put that $100 bill in my pocket.
When did you figure out that it was fake?
Yeah.
At what point?
The next morning. The next morning, I went and I'm like, I, I came up on 100.
No, no.
It's the shoo-shoo money.
It's fake money.
Looking like $100 bill, but when you flip it over, it says copy. I was like, oh, you're a bum. You're a bum.
That's what you get for being a bum.
Yeah, that's what. Oh,
that's
man.
What you get. Oh, that's funny.
Yeah, and then I passed it on to Teresa.
So you gave it to your wife.
Yeah, one day she was, you know, son, I'm here, babe, take 100. Let's go. Don't worry about it. I was like, go ahead. Like I'm big time.
She was gonna get rolled up at the store trying to use some fake money.
She realized, will you never just give me
$100?
What's going on?
What's the catch?
Yeah, what's going on? You know, but she doesn't know. You know, it took her about 5 minutes to realize.
But, yeah. Wow, Dad.
So
that's actually pretty funny.
Yeah.
But I'll send Maria, who's our editor, some clips and videos that she can put in. If you guys watch us on YouTube, then you could check out the boys and their dad. It was pretty cool to see. But because the wedding was on Zaire's birthday, we weren't able to celebrate his birthday with him. Then he spent the week, he had them for the week. So now we finally got to celebrate Zaire's birthday a week later, now that the boys are back in town.
Right.
So we all got together last night, celebrated Zaire's birthday, had the family over. And
yeah, it was really nice.
It was fun. It was fun to hang out.
Yeah,
it was the day after Halloween, just for reference time. So I'll put some pictures in here. Ace still had his Joker tattoos on from Halloween that I didn't realize were so hard to come off.
Oh, that's right. He's still tatted.
He's still tatted. He's like they're finally fading.
Like a gangster.
Yes. You know. So he's still tatted. And I have a story about that. I was going to tell you offline, but now that we're talking about it, I might as well tell you here.
Okay, let's go.
So Ace is walking around the kitchen. He has on maybe like just his pamper because 9 times out of 10, this is at mom's house.
Okay.
So everybody's there. So my grandpa's there. My grandpa has this girlfriend, Sharon. That's all I'm going to say about that. And Sharon looked at
him. I'll say.
What?
She's only 2 years older than me.
Yes. So she's pretty young.
My old dad, the player.
And Papa has a young girl and whatever.
Whatever, yeah.
Whatever.
Yeah, we'll let it go.
We'll let it go.
She's a nice lady.
She's nice.
She's good to him.
But she irritated me yesterday.
Well, what'd she do?
So we're in the kitchen and Ace walks in with his pamper and his tattoos all over his body. And she looks at him and kind of like is trying to figure it out. And then she looks at me and goes, when did Ace get a tattoo?
Oh, she didn't realize.
No. And then she goes, He has a tattoo. And then she just kept saying it. And she looks at me and my mom and goes, does he have a tattoo? And me and my mom go, yeah. Yeah, he does. He does.
Now, you guys got to understand. This tattoo is going across his chest. Yes.
A big ass tattoo on his arm. Yes. One on his face, like a little dot on his face. Yeah. There was a star on his hand. Like there are multiple tats.
Right.
So she looks at me at mom and is all and so serious. Like, when did he get this tattoo?
Well, see,
is he tattooed? So we both go, yeah, Sharon, he's tatted.
Right.
He's really has tattoos. He's two and he's tatted. And then she just kind of looks at us and we look at her like, what? Like, what are you about to say now?
Right,
then she goes, well, you never know with you young moms. And so then I looked at her and said, you should just get out.
Right.
I think it's time for you to go. I didn't see her anymore the rest of the night.
Okay.
I'm telling you, the rest of the night. And I think she might have left after I told her to get out.
She did disappear.
She disappeared.
Yeah.
I think she probably got offended by me saying, it's time to leave. You should go. But it was just so.
And she was having such a good time before.
I'm just warning you now.
All right. I'll make sure it's all clear.
If she comes back to you and is like,
I'll clean it up.
Margaret and Cheyenne bullied me in the kitchen. I just want to let you know the backstory. She really sat there and told me because.
Well, maybe she thought it was real.
I'm a young mom.
See,
I'm going to tattoo my 2-year old to look like a little. See,
but if she. A little gangster. Yeah,
it was, big old
I want to say a face tat. Yeah.
An arm tat.
Yeah.
A wrist tat.
If she thought it was real though, and obviously she did, she didn't understand. She thought she didn't have kids, so she didn't relate to Halloween. She probably thought they were real.
dead.
Initially.
That's who tattoos a two-year-old?
Well, that's why she was someone, that's why she was like, a tattoo?
And then she tried to play me when she realized it wasn't a tattoo and say, well, you just never know, you young moms. I swear, when she hit me with that line, I said, you should just get out. Yeah, you should just get out. On your face. Oh, I did it with the biggest smile. Just so if she ever said I bullied her, I could say, I was smiling. I was just funning. I was just playing around. Woo. But I tell you, it happened, right? And me and Mom sat in the kitchen for like a good 5 minutes like, what the hell? And then we realized about an hour later, we said, where'd Sharon go?
She vamoosed.
She disappeared she after
did.
That.
She did. She cut out.
She cut out. Did she say bye to you?
I don't remember saying bye to me.
Because I she remember didn't say, that, I'm I remember telling you, she like, cut okay, so out
my
after
pop is 87. Mm-hmm. Okay. You know what's really a trip is I listen to the news all the time. All these people that are passing 82, 83, you know, younger than him. And I'm just like, go, pop, go. But anyway, when he was there, I don't worry about him because she's there and she kind of takes care of him.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden she wasn't there. So I said, so then now it's not like he's not feeble or anything like that. You know, it's not like he needs 24-hour care.
He can take care of himself, but it's just to make sure he's fine. Right, you want anything, Papa?
Right, like, right. So I know she's not there, so I'm like, okay. I think she got offended with the tattoo thing, and I'm just putting a bug in your ear now
because Mom and I looked at her like she was crazy.
Yeah.
But.
Ooh, boy.
I swear I was in the kitchen like, are you kidding me, lady? But anyway.
Well, she probably thought that she didn't. Dad. The tattoos looked good. They really did. The decal. Well,
okay,
decals.
And then the choice of words. I'm going to tattoo Joker on my two-year-old.
Is that what it said?
A big old Joker.
I didn't even
right
say
there.
I was just like, cello. my little Mexican grandson. He's a straight gangster.
And then he had a little G on his eye. And then a star on his hand. And he's walking around saying, look. He's trying to show his
and
shit.
And then
up.
Had a little.
Yes.
Yeah, he was showing them off.
He was showing them off.
Okay, come on. Let's get to business. Let's.
Where's your phone? Because the questions are on your phone. I sent them to you. But I was happy that Papa came out because he is getting older and you could tell he is getting older. But it was good that he did come out. Go to our text messages. Do you delete our text?
No.
Okay, so.
Me and you?
Yeah, and then here.
All right, go.
All right. So last week, we put up that Q&A of like sending your stories and stuff like that. And we hit a lot of them, but there were still some that we did not get. So I'm going to start from the top so that this time we can be ourselves accountability partners. So, this one, I'm trying to see where it starts because it's a little confused. Okay, I think it starts here.
Okay.
My stepson's mother is trying to come back into the picture after 3 years.
Which is a good thing.
In my opinion.
On the face.
She is not really fit and she comes as she goes as she wants.
Oh, she's having problems.
I'm very protective of my kids and she and I don't see eye to eye because of it. My husband thinks it's important for her to be in our son's life. I don't agree because I don't think she does more. Don't agree because I think she does more harm than good.
I remember
and
this.
He has me help.
Okay. And see, that's, I remember this. And then at the end when she says, and because I'm already thinking, don't feel, what's the word? Don't feel intimidated because your guy's ex-woman is coming around. And then when she ended it with, and he has me, you know, period. So let me say this. From your husband's point of view, and look, from my point of view, the mother, and it sounds like you're a very good woman, that you've stepped in as the stepmother and have adopted and have taken this child on like he's yours. He or she, right?
Stepson.
And that's very admirable. And hats off. Because everybody can't do that. Yeah. But hats off, okay? She, meaning the mother, sounds like she's not in a good place or was not in a good place at some point, and maybe she's in a better place now, okay? But don't get caught up in this battle between your man's love. He loves you. He doesn't love her. He had a baby with her, and now he's trying to maybe take care of her for her. Not because he's in love with her, but just, you know, I had a child with it. And maybe at one time he did love her. I don't know. But he's trying to take care of her. Let this man be a man and do the right thing. Don't be intimidated by her presence. He has chosen you. You know what I mean?
No, I agree. I think when I read it the first time, because you guys know when you send, when you put up a question box, it's like you can only put so many words in at once.
Right.
So I read it and I'm like, okay. And then I read some more. I'm like, okay, okay. And then once I got to the last one where it says that he has me, that's when I was like, okay, oh, now I can kind of see where like maybe your personality is coming out. And if that's the argument, then I can't agree with you. Like,
don't be intimidated.
Yeah, it doesn't matter.
I don't mean to cut you off. Don't be intimidated by this other woman. She's coming around and it is the right thing. Let this woman try to better her life and be in her son's life. So she screwed up early in life. She did. And you were there. And admirable. And hats off. Okay? Give her a chance. Don't worry about your and his relationship. That's solid. She's not going to get in there. Believe me. I'm sorry. I didn't mean to cut you off. Go
ahead. It's okay. Go ahead. I agree with you. Honestly, yeah. Agree with you. Yeah. I feel like...
You want to go check out him?
Yeah.
What's okay. happening? Anyway, I got both mics. It's all my world right now. Okay, for the young lady that sent this in, we already see you're a good woman. You stepped in, you've helped raise these kids, all I'm doing is reemphasizing what I've already said. Do not let this other woman, and I know some people don't like the word intimidate, so let me try to change the word. Don't let her rock your world. Don't let her change your disposition. She is not all of a sudden going to be your husband's girl. It's not happening. He's chosen you. He's down with you, probably because of the personality and the caring person that you are. Don't stop being that. And don't worry. Don't be jealous. Don't be envious. Don't worry about her. Okay? Give her a shot. If anything, you really want to be a superwoman, support her. Support her in her avenue to try to help. Try to bridge her gap, bridge the gap with her husband. I mean, with her, who's a Freudian, with her son. And yes, it may be true that maybe she does more harm than good. But still, you got to understand a child's perspective is they love their parents, their mom, their dad, especially their mom. They just love them. They love them, even when they're wrong. It takes a long time for a kid to realize that their parent has been foul. But it's not up to you to point that out. You have to give the child, when they become an adult, a chance to realize that. Okay? I'm going to put it on pause for a minute.
My kid had a little freak out moment upstairs, but I was trying to say that I think as a mom and as somebody that also deals with like a stepmom, like I have Ryder has a stepmom, you know, I view Taylor as Ryder's stepmom. The dynamic of a mom and a stepmom can be challenging sometimes. I feel like from listening to Taylor talk about her experiences being like in the stepmom position, she said sometimes it's harder to be the stepmom than to be the mom because there's certain boundaries, lines, you know, all these things and dynamics. And I was listening to her and I was like, I guess I never thought about it that way.
Yeah.
So I do think that it is a tough relationship sometimes, especially if you're not in a good place, but it's one that you guys have to figure out how to be on the same team and not on opposing teams because the main goal is for the child that's involved. Now, you are the stepmom that's been playing the role as the mom.
Mother. And I think she considers herself
and
the mother.
And I think that you consider yourself
which is beautiful.
The mom, which is great. But also realize there's no, as long as his biological mother is not, you know, harming him or putting him in danger, then I think that it would be also great for you to step back and let his mom play a role in his life and realize that it doesn't take away from your role right. as his mother.
It doesn't.
It doesn't take away from your role as his father's wife, like allowing his mother, the biological mom, to come in and to play a role doesn't take away from you. So I hope that you do listen to this episode and see that we answered that question. And maybe there's more to the story and we're just hitting surface level. So if you have a response, or, you know, you hear what we say and have, or like, well, what about this? Or what about that? Or maybe that is a different perspective. Let us know. Like, I want to know what your feedback is from hearing what our feedback was towards the DM. And sometimes there is more to the story. So keep us posted on what happens.
So I just want to say one last thing. Mm-hmm. And it's in relationship to the stepmom-mom relationship. Like me, I have, my mom has always been in my life. I had a stepmom that I loved to death. Okay. I mean, I've been very fortunate that I've had, you know, three good mothers representing in different parts of my life. So don't think that just because her mom comes around, it's going to squeeze you out. It's not. That's just a side note.
Yeah. So. I agree.
But she sounds like she's a good woman, and, you know.
Let her play a role.
Yeah, yeah. Let the mom, even if she...
Even if she hasn't played a role, let her play a role.
Even if the mom's a piece of shit, you got to let her get in there and try to get her shit, get her stuff together. Okay? I mean, you're fortunate. You're blessed. You've got a good head on your shoulders. You've been there. You know, you're taking care of the kids. So the mom's had a different situation. Let her get in there and try to get it together.
Okay, guys, this is the next one. It starts off with, "Dear Mr. Floyd."
Ooh. Ooh. Mr. Floyd, wow.
Right. "And Cheyenne, please read to the end. My name is blank. I would like to stay anonymous, please. I just really want your opinion because I see how strong your family unit is. So I recently moved out of my dad's house due to our relationship not being what I wanted it to be. Verbally and physically abusive. And I also don't have the best relationship with my mom. She's been inconsistent in my life since I was about 15 to 16. I just want to know if you guys have ever been at odds with your parents during your early 20s, and how did you fix it? Also, what advice would you give me on how to conduct myself now that I'm on my own and struggling? I'm trying to pay for nursing school and to buy a car. My father took my car when we were at odds." Right off the bat, I would say that if your father is physically abusive towards you, then I don't think that's a relationship I would necessarily want to mend.
What does that mean, though, physical abuse? Does that mean he's like...
Verbal abuse? Okay, yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
Is that what that means?
Yeah, physical is putting your hands on someone. Verbal would be more of like... verbally abusing you, calling you out your name, mentally abusing you. You know what I mean? But physical, would that mean somebody's hitting you?
Okay, so let's verbal abuse. You're lazy. You're not handling your business. You're pathetic.
Or it can go deeper.
Is that?
I think that's just like, to me, that's more of just like, I guess some people would consider that verbal abuse.
They would.
Some people would
consider it.
Just like mean.
Constructive criticism.
Okay, well, let's say he's going deeper, as in like F you and F your mom and F your life. And
okay.
Then that's verbal abuse.
What's so tricky about these, because you guys use terms, and these terms can be wide open.
But physical abuse is physical abuse. You either hit me or you didn't hit me.
Yeah, but see, I don't want physical abuse to be like, stop and listen to me.
I'm going to chalk it up that she's saying physical abuse and that it's actual physical abuse.
See, my only problem is, and I'm not saying you, young lady. I'm saying sometimes people exaggerate. No, you need to come here.
Okay, why do you keep using me as an example?
Okay, but I'm saying, is that physical abuse?
No.
Some people even know.
But some people would say yes. Like,
yes.
Okay, well, but can I'm you like, clarify if it...
I need to get her attention. She is my teenage daughter. I'm trying to teach her.
Well, let's just say that that what she's talking about is actual verbal abuse and physical abuse. Okay. And if that is the case, then I would try, if you're already in your 20s, to...
Be grown
and...
Separate
yourself from your father. If he's physically abusing you, my advice would be to separate yourself from him. Probably look up some therapy things or group therapy that you can find online options, because I feel like if you've gone through physical abuse or mental abuse or verbal abuse, then it's traumatic and it's a trauma. And at some point, it's going to come out in your life. So I think finding a place or a space where you can talk about it to learn how to overcome that, then I think that is a great step in a direction for you. And as far as your mom, maybe that's a relationship that you seek after. Yeah, there's been some inconsistencies, but if she hasn't hit you or beat you or, you know, done some of the negative things that your father has done, then maybe that's a relationship where you guys try to figure out and work out your how to have a relationship with each other. But if you're in your 20s and your parents have been, like, shitty this whole time, then that's when I say, like, find your own community or build your own family. And I have plenty of friends who have built their own community and built their own families, and it's not with their blood parents or their blood siblings. It's when your friends turn into your family, and they've acknowledged, I had to build my community because I didn't have that relationship with my parents or with my siblings the same way that they would see when they're around us. Mm-hmm. And I think it's a hard reality. I've watched a few of my friends have to face that reality, especially when they're friends with me and they see the dynamic and the relationship I have with my parents, and they can see the difference between what I have versus what they don't have. And I've had one friend who said, it was too much for me. I don't want to be a friend. Like, I hate the fact that you have people you can call on. And then I had another friend who was like, can I call on your parents? I don't have parents to call on. And they had to build their own community of finding resources. What do you think?
I really liked your answer. Because initially, with a little bit of reserve, I'm going to say what I was going to say.
Okay.
You might need to check yourself. If your parents are reasonable people, you're not getting along with either one of them, it might be you. It's hard for a person to check themselves, but just check yourself. You know, you throw that caveat that your father's both mentally and physically abusive and he's taking your car away. You know, I don't know if that's a punishment or an incentive. I don't know. He got you a car, so can't be too, well, he could be out of line. I don't know. But let's get past all that. Let's forget what I just said about it being you. You just do a personal check. You know your situation better than any of us. And if you've been difficult, sometimes you have to understand you've been difficult and need to admit that and reconcile that by changing your ways, changing what's your priority. You know, if they're trying to keep you on the straight and narrow and you're going wild and out of bounds, well, it's going to create a difficult situation. And I'm not saying that's the case. I don't know. Okay. But let's just deal with your last deal with any suggestions on how, any suggestions on helping you get through this period of struggle. It's just part of the game. When I was your age, I was struggling. It wasn't so much a struggle with my mom and dad's relationship. They were there, but I was moving so fast and so fast and furious, trying to grow up, trying to be 20 and on my own. And it's not an easy period. So don't think that there's any magic pixie dust anybody can sprinkle over. It's no amount of money. It's no amount of wisdom. It's really just, you just got to grind through this. You know, try to stay as clean as you can. You know, don't get lost in drinking too much, smoking too much, partying too much. You know, that's number one. Try to handle your business. Try to have some goals. Write your goals down. Try to have a path and a plan and a program.
Yeah.
Stick to the program. Yes, you're going to be a little bit broke. In terms of car, do you really need a car right now? You certainly don't need a new car. You don't need a new car payment. I know that. You know, you should be doing a bucket. You know, if not a bucket, maybe public transportation, but, you know. So try to keep your bills as low as possible so that the money that you're making can go as far as possible. Keep on studying, keep on developing, and, you know, let's see. You got to, what's the word? Persevere? Mm-hmm. Persevere. Because it's a tough time. 20 is a tough time. I don't care if you have a silver spoon in your mouth. You know what I mean? Say silver.
Yeah.
It's still tough. This is a tough period.
What do you think about what advice would you give her as far as fixing the relationship with her parents?
So with your parents, again, first thing I do is check yourself. And only because I know a lot of times when you're that age, you think you know it all. Okay. And your parents, though they may not be perfect, still because of the years that they've got, know a little bit more. Even if it's them checking themselves, knowing that they were wrong. But let's say that you want to repair or develop a better relationship. Start to show up and show up the best that you can. Okay? Just the best that you can. Now, if they're foul, or if they're, use the word ignorant, ignorant just meaning they don't know how to be a better parent, well, that's on them. Okay? But you personally show up the best that you can. And take it slow. There's no rush. You're only 20. I'm assuming that they're probably 40, 50. That gives them, you know, so everybody's got plenty of time.
Yeah.
Okay? Don't rush it. And sometimes it takes years apart to grow before you can come together. They need to, you know, maybe it's them that need to mature. Maybe it's you that need to mature. You never know. I mean, I don't know in this situation.
Yeah.
But give it time. There's no rush. This, whenever you show up the best that you can. And if it becomes hostile anyway, you walk away and you try it again in another 6 months, 4 months, 2 years. You know, okay?
I like that. I like the showing up the best you can.
Yeah, the best that you can. That's, you know, in a lot of situations, that's all you can do. You can't be responsible or take on the burden of the other person. You can take on the whole responsibility of you.
Yeah.
And being the best that you can. What does that mean? That means giving grace, being personally responsible and accountable, being manful, being, you know, offering forgiveness, being humble. Being here, I always say this. When I'm in a problem situation, I just think, if I was to mimic or mock Jesus, how would I do it? You don't have to believe in the Bible and you don't have to be a Christian. You know the story of Jesus and kind of how he was. If you can imitate that, mock that, how would he do it? How would he handle the situation? Probably forgive him and try to have another powwow, you know, and you know, that's the best I can offer right now. I wish you the best.
Yeah. I want to know what happens.
I like your. I really did like your answer, though. So go back when you rewind this and listen to what she said again. Besides the relationship with your parents, make sure that you are doing what you need to do at this point in your life, and that's grinding it through. If it's school that you're doing it, do it. If it's career that you're doing it, do it. Okay, get past some of the humps. You know, and again, I'm gonna say this. I think I said it already. Have some goals, write them down, follow through, okay, so that you can get through this, all right?
So the next one, she said, my husband left me 2 months after I gave birth. How do I apply Papa's motto to this? So I saw this and I thought, okay, this would be one that I knew we would want to cover. I mean, we've covered all of them.
Papa's motto being, if it's not a problem, it's not a problem unless you make it one.
Right. So I did message her and say, like, we're going to discuss this on the podcast, but I had more questions. So my first question I asked was, how long were they married for and how long did they date? She said they dated for a year, been married for a year. And then I asked what was his reason for leaving. So she sent a response back.
Okay.
She said his reason for leaving was because I wasn't contributing financially after he told me to quit my job. Then he got me pregnant shortly after and acted as he resented me. I was 2 months postpartum when he left, never asked me how I was doing. Never asked me, am I okay? How am I doing? Nothing ever. He acts as if he's angry at me and I don't understand. I send him photos of our child and he doesn't respond. He'll ask, how is she doing? I'll tell him. Then he won't respond. Part of me wants to consult him about signing off his rights. So she also sent you a private DM a little while ago that I pulled from your page.
Okay.
Just giving everybody full story at this point. Her DM to you said, my husband left me when I was 2 months postpartum, went on with his life, and acts like I don't exist. Right. He checks in on our child and helps a little financially, but the way he co-parents is odd. He never asks me if I'm doing okay, how I'm feeling, how he can help with their child. He just sees her on his visit days and sends money. I want to approach him about how I feel, but he would just get defensive how he does in every situation and victimize himself. How do I apply? It's not a problem unless you make it one to this. I love the motto, but it is difficult in this situation. Sometimes I want to go on no contact with him. Please help. Help me on how to navigate the situation. He's very prideful and egotistic. I got to pull my nose.
You know, sometimes I just have initial reaction. My initial reaction is a piece of shit. Okay? You know, and that's based on him leaving you.
Right after you just had a baby.
After 2 months in postpartum, new baby. You know, piece of shit. Sometimes that's just, you know, that's just what I thought that a year of dating and a year of marriage was too soon. I personally, okay.
Oh wait, they're both 22.
Oh, see,
I knew we shouldn't have done this.
There we go. See, remember last week?
No.
Too young, too full of cum. Okay,
they're about to be 23.
Young, the young and dumb, young, dumb, full of cum. Okay, I don't know. Okay, but let's try to
young,
help.
Dumb, and full of cum is the grossest thing that can come out.
Hey, man,
your
look,
mouth.
But how true is it? How true is it, though? How true is it?
Okay. I feel like there's so much to unpack here.
Yeah, serious.
Let's start from the beginning.
All right. Too young to get married.
Hold on. This is how Ryder's going to cheer practice.
So fly.
Yeah, put it in the cubby at cheer.
And wait a minute. Is that tattoos? You got tattoos? How you, wait. You don't have to wiggle your hips just to walk, okay?
Sorry.
That's what. Okay.
I'm really trying to figure out. Okay, one, I'm not even going to get stuck on the fact that you guys are 22. I'm not going there because
we're going to stay on that just for a second.
No.
Just for a second.
No.
Because I got beat up.
There's plenty of 22-year-olds who had kids and got married and stayed married.
Oh yeah. Give me a list of them. There are. You can do it and be successful, but again, I just think it's too young. And there are some people, and after I told you, I got beat up. There are some other people that co-signed with me and said, "Papa Floyd, I understand. I've got boys. They're not thinking about getting married. I've got girls that are like, can we have a wedding?
So, to your point, they were obviously too young.
Too young. Let's get past that.
Okay.
Let's find something to build on. Okay. And again, he may be a piece of shit, but it may be because he's young and immature.
Yeah.
All right. That's a bit. You don't understand. It's not easy. And well, no, you know now as a mother. Okay, at 22. With a 2 month plus old baby, it's not easy. Okay? Financially, mentally, physically, emotionally. I mean, you love them to death and nobody's taken away from that, but it's still difficult. Look, I was in a household with me, my wife, and my mother-in-law, and it was still tough. My mother-in-law would help. I mean, she helped financially, she helped babysit, she helped, you know, it's still tough. It's a tough road.
Dang.
So,
I just think from reading it and keywords that stood out to me was, okay, we got pregnant, resentment started then, and the financial thing, he didn't want me to work, told me to quit, but then he wanted money, or wanted me to be supportive more financially. So, it's just certain things that stand out to me. I would say getting pregnant at 22 and then the dad starts to resent you, I see how they align. Maybe if he didn't necessarily want,
he didn't want it, but it happened.
It happened.
He was going to try to make it
right,
happen.
Right, right. And now I feel like that's when resentment comes into play. Is now I'm in this situation. I have this kid, but I feel like I don't want this kid. But I'm still gonna.
I don't think it's that. I mean, I don't think it's that a person, a father, a man says, "I don't want this kid." He doesn't want this whole bundle.
What's the bundle? The marriage bundle, and the baby. Marriage,
the baby, the woman, the focus. I need to be career oriented now. I can't play anymore. You know, I got to do.
So you think he doesn't want the whole bundle?
He may not be ready for it. You know, look at 22. I know I wasn't ready for it.
What do you think about her wanting Tim to sign the rights away?
Don't do that. Don't, you know, give it time. You know, he is very could well be could in shock right now. Okay. All this has hit him. And if he's not a mature, look, if he's not a mature person, if he's not a player hustler, if he's not a go-getter, if he's not.
But I want to give him some credit because on her DM to you.
He said he pays.
She said he sees her on his visit days.
And he pays.
And he sends money.
Let me tell you something. There's a lot of brothers that don't pay.
That is a lot than some.
Yes. Yeah. A lot of times it's a struggle to get that.
What stands out to me is that you, in multiple messages, have said he never asked me if I'm okay or how I'm feeling.
Right,
and
right.
I think that's because you still have feelings towards him, whether you're still in love, whether you like him, whether you're so freaking mad at him, but you still love him, whether you, all those things, you still want some tie. There's still some tie to
you're
him.
You're getting your feelings hurt.
And you're getting your feelings hurt because he's not checking in on you necessarily.
Yes.
Because it sounds like he is still showing up on the days that he has visits. He is still sending money, whether it's a lot of money or a little money, he's sending money. And whether it's multiple visit days or some visit days, it sounds like he's showing up on the days that you guys have scheduled.
Okay.
So you can't get mad if he's only showing up for the child and no longer showing up for you.
Yeah, we're going to take him out of the category of being a piece of shit.
Yeah, you have to read deeper into what she's saying.
Initially, I thought he was a piece of shit.
I don't think he's a piece of shit.
I think he's just young.
I think he's a piece of shit because he left her 2 months postpartum. I think that is like, really?
That qualifies him.
That qualifies
him.
But
that's not enough to keep him in the
box. And that's not enough to sign away somebody's rights.
Yeah, don't do that. Look, you need to give yourself time. Give him time to mature. Okay? It could be a whole lot worse. He could be not sending you nothing and not showing up at all. But he is. Give your relationship a shot. It sounds like they're divorced, right?
No, he left her.
He left her.
My husband left me when I was 2 months postpartum. Doesn't that mean they divorced?
Moved out?
Yeah.
No, that doesn't mean divorce. Divorce is divorce.
Okay, well, she said he left. I don't know if they're divorced or not.
Okay. Regardless if you are.
They're not together.
I don't care about marriage certificates, divorce certificates. I don't care, okay? Give him. I'm assuming that you guys were in love, and Jen, this was not a one night stand. We got pregnant.
No, they dated for a year. Right. They've been married for a year.
Right. So I believe that you guys gave it an honest shot. Keep on. Don't. There are mistakes that have been made, obviously. Okay. There have been hearts that have been broken, obviously. He's bordering on the piece of shit category, but maybe not. I haven't heard his story, and there's two sides to every story. Give it time. Do the best you can. Create a relationship with him. Not the same relationship that you had.
Yeah.
Okay? But create it so that you guys are at the very least, what? Co-parenting.
And start there. Your co-parenting relationship might not look like how you want it to look now, but acknowledge that you do have some form of a co-parenting relationship because you use words like visit day. He is financially sending something. Mm-hmm. So you are co-parenting in some form or fashion, but it just doesn't look like how you want it to, because you clearly still have some sort of feelings towards the relationship or towards him, because you're mad that he's not checking in on you.
On you. And I picked that up too.
I understand that completely. Okay. I would be pissed off if I just had your baby and you're not about to ask me if I'm okay.
Yes. And look, it's okay to feel that way.
Yeah, rightfully so.
It's okay to be selfish like that.
Yes.
I don't want to use the word selfish because it has a negative connotation.
But yeah, but okay, I would be selfish in that moment.
Yes, it's
completely.
Okay. Now, she also went on to say about him being prideful. Okay. And again, you know, my thing on pride is overrated. So, but he's 22. So again, young and dumb. And that, you guys take it when I'm saying young and dumb, I'm talking in general. And you have to understand what I'm saying. Don't take what I'm saying literally. I'm not calling him a dumb man. I'm just saying at that point, sometimes you don't realize that pride is overstated, that pride is overrated. Okay. You know, so just give it a chance. Give him a chance. It may take a year. It may take three. It may take 5 years. I don't know. Okay? Do your best with the relationship. Do not light a fire and throw gasoline on it.
Yeah. And I think bringing up signing away your rights or stopping
contact is
lighting a fire when I think you're in the height of being hurt and upset and you're still going through postpartum right now.
Yeah.
Which heightens all your emotions. Yeah. I had terrible postpartum. So I get it. I'm not taking that away from you, but I'm saying take all your stuff and put it over here and think strictly about the baby.
Right.
And if he's showing up for the baby, he's not showing up for you. That right now you have to accept that.
You have to kind of swallow that one for right
and
now.
And give it grace.
Make the importance is the relationship with you and the child and him with the child.
Yeah.
You and your former husband or lover, that relationship can work its way out, but don't bury the kid.
In the meantime,
yes.
So okay? How do you apply the motto to this? It's not a problem unless you make it one.
Well, this is how you apply it. I got with a guy. He wasn't what I thought he was, but I'm still strong, so I'm going to still make it. Me and my child are going to be fine. Okay.
I hate when you apply that model.
Well, I mean, that's just the way it is.
Sometimes it's so annoying.
Sometimes things don't work out in the. I'm not saying in a dream world, but ideally, they just don't. That model doesn't take things and this make everything nice. Okay, but what it does is it makes everything tolerable, where you can still go through and make the best of what you have. And see, right now, she's still a strong mother. He is a contributing father. And that's what you work with. You don't sit up there and harp on, he left me. He did. That's not what you harp on. You don't harp on, I got postpartum. I do, but I'm going to get by that. The thing is, look, you still got to be strong. You still have to be a mother. And if you're the single mother, you're not going to be the first, only in the last. It's not going to happen. I mean, that's just not the way it is. Be strong. Be courageous. Do like you're doing. Talk to us. Talk to family. Talk to counselors. Do what you need to do. Get in programs. Find money. Find programs. Do what you need to do to be a successful mom. He is who he is. And at some point, if he doesn't get stronger, I mean, becoming more of a, it becomes just a period. It's a point. You and your kid got to keep going. So, no, it's not a problem. Do what you got to do.
I cannot wait for you to listen to this and give us feedback. Let us know what you think about what our opinions are. And also realize we don't know the whole story. So, you know.
We know it's not easy.
Yeah. And don't think that we're saying, oh, this is so easy. Let him do come and as he pleases and as he wants. And that's definitely not what we're saying. So I don't want you to take it as that at all.
Now, when you say that, you know, to a certain extent through communication, and I'm not talking about an altercation, but communication. You want to kind of make him accountable, you know, in terms of his visitation, his financial contribution, and him being a father, okay? You, at the same time, understand your accountability in terms of being a mother. You know, your mother, you are the bus mother, but also to make sure that relationship is there for your child and the child's father also. I'm assuming he's a good guy. I'm really taking him out of the piece of shit category. you married him. So I'm thinking he's a good guy. Maybe the marriage, but again, I think he was young. Yeah. It was too much for him, you know, and that happens. Sometimes it just happens.
I would love to hear from him.
I would too. Maybe we can get him on. Maybe you can ask him a call.
I would love to hear what he has to say.
Yeah. There's, let me tell you something, guys. There's always two sides to every story. Yeah. Okay. If not multiple sides. Yeah. Okay. Best of luck to you. Yeah, best sure. wishes for you.
Let us know what happens.
Yeah, please do. Please do.
Okay. Our last one is a DM. And she said, I've been with my S.O.
Yeah, I saw that too.
What's an significant S-O? Other? Oh.
Finally, it took me a while. It took me a while. First, I thought she misspelled it and it was her boo. It took me a minute.
Okay.
Significant other.
I've been with my S.O. for 1.5 years, but we're not even officially girlfriend and boyfriend because he does not want to commit. And his reading is because he's 28 and the relationship is not his priority. However, he says the relationship we have is important to him. I always go back and forth with, is this something even worth staying through? Is that a sign to run? Sorry, my allergies are so bad today, which is why my eyes look like this. My face is puffy and I keep blowing my nose.
At 28, I don't know if he's got career going, but what he's saying, a relationship is not there. See, 28 to me is the time when you start to settle down. Maybe it gets extended out to year 35. You know, because you could still be building. You still be building your career, making some money, dating. Nothing wrong with that.
I think, don't they say that guys aren't, like, ready for marriage until, like, 33, 35 or something? I feel like that's what statistics say right now. I would say at 28, as a female at 28, and I've been with somebody for a year and a half, and they're not ready to even call me their girlfriend yet, I would have an issue with that. Mm. I would have an issue with that. And I would have to make a decision, which I think you're trying to make a decision for yourself right now. Do I stay or do I go? But the way you guys are moving at snail speed right now, you're not even his girlfriend yet and you're 28. Let's say, okay, by 29 and a half, you're finally his girlfriend. So now how long does it take for you guys to get engaged? Now are we 31, 32, 35, like,
yeah.
Like the clock is just not.
I remember rereading this.
And thinking what?
And then I posted, you need to dump him.
You need to dump him.
On his, I think it said you need to dump on his head and keep it moving.
Yeah, I just feel like, you know? I'm not even, I want to know how, I wonder how old you are. Because, hey, Mr. Man, with your flask, just commit and pour it.
Oh, yeah, just commit.
Yes.
I was trying to do it off screen.
I think that this is when the ultimatum comes in. I think this is when you give them an ultimatum. We're either going to be together or I'm out.
Can you really pop an ultimatum within a year and a half, though?
Just to be girlfriend and boyfriend, yeah.
Yeah, to be committed.
To at be that girlfriend age, and boyfriend at that age. Age, yeah.
But, you know,
28 is so close to 30.
I don't know.
I'm not dating. This is my thing. If I'm not dating anybody unless we're working for a common goal of marriage. At that age,
yeah.
28, 29, 30, that's that. We're on the same place to get married, right?
I think that's an ideal age to settle in.
And you can't even commit to be my boyfriend?
Yeah. Well, he's still, you know, he.
So. No, I would either say give him the ultimatum or it's time to bounce. Yeah. It's ultimatum or it's time to go. And okay. Even I don't really like the whole ultimatum thing, honestly. So it might be time to go. And I hate to say this, but I feel like sometimes I've seen so many relationships.
She's only put a year and a half in it.
But he doesn't even want to commit to being a boyfriend, girlfriend.
There's no kids.
A year and a half of dating the same person and they don't want to call me their girlfriend?
No, time to bounce.
Yes, there's it's no time kids. To go.
There's nothing holding her in other than her
other
love
than
for
the
him.
Love, which I'm saying, you can either say, hey, it's been a year and a half. If you can't even commit to being my boyfriend, I'm going to go and date other people now. Yeah. Because please believe, he is probably dating other people. He doesn't have a girlfriend.
I'd like to defend him, but I don't think it could.
I think that the only reason that you don't want that title is what?
You know, the boyfriend title?
Yeah. It leaves the door open for other opportunities, other people, other experiences.
Yeah, yeah.
And they can always go back and say, yeah, we were committed, but you're not my girlfriend.
Yeah, well, I mean, personally, that's why I didn't call people my girlfriend, because I didn't want to, even if I wasn't seeing other people, I wanted that door to still be open.
The door is still open. Yeah. So
I would probably say, look, you know, year and a half may seem like it's been a long time to you, but you're only, what, 2 years, 28 now?
28. So you might want to break up with them so you can start dating other people, because. Or,
if not break up, at least throw the ultimatum. I mean, if you really,
I think it's ultimatum or breakup.
Yeah, throw the ultimatum. It's like, look, and I'm not saying ultimatum with marriage.
No,
like, look,
just if he can't even be my boyfriend.
Yes, if he's not even doing that, that means, and this, you know what? If he's not doing it, it's okay. He's being honest with you, okay? But now you need to be honest about the relationship.
Yeah,
it's not one that is equivocally committed to.
And be honest with yourself. Like, what do you really think is happening? Like, there has to be a reason other than, I don't want a girlfriend right now because I'm 28. Like, there's more to that than just that age. There's more to it. That you're leaving, he's leaving that door open for a reason. What, Dad?
I can't say it. I'll tell you, maybe you can reword it.
I'm not saying that.
Okay, all right. See, I told you, I don't know how to say that nice.
Okay, guys. Thank you so much for tuning in this week to Unfiltered Kitchen.
Okay, so there's a few people that are close. If you want to know what I said, just DM me, I'll let you know.
Yeah, if you want to know what he just whispered in my ear, DM him. I'm not saying it, and it's not appropriate to say out loud.
But it is a possibility.
It is a possibility.
Yeah, see?
But I really appreciate you guys tuning in this week, and we want to keep this going. Send us in more situations, questions, problems, concerns, life-threatening things,
non-life-threatening
things.
Not life-threatening.
You don't have no advice to give with that?
No, I'm not messing with that.
He said I'm not qualified. Look,
we're having fun. We're having a good time.
I want to hear some stories.
Not life-threatening.
Why not?
Call 911.
Oh, my God.
call 911. Don't call us. Okay?
Call us. Call us, please. No, really. Send more. Keep talking to us. Yeah.
You know what, though? I said this last one. I'm going to say it one more time. Can you tell a friend to tell a friend? If I got there, then I know that you guys are down with us, and I'll hang out.
Oh, he's going to leave me soon.
Well, no, you understand. Well, see, they don't understand. It costs money to do this.
It does.
Anyway, guys, good seeing you guys. Always nice.
Yes.
It was good seeing you, too.
Thanks, Dad.
Always enjoy our conversations. Enjoy our conversations with Kyle, too. Maybe there'll be three of us one day.
Okay.
We got to start bringing some guests in.
We do. But, you know, we just started, so.
Okay, you're right.
We had to establish our relationship
Yeah,
first.
Still neophytes. Yeah, you're right.
We're still neophytes.
Yeah, we're babies. We're babies doing this.
Okay, guys. We will be back next week with another episode.
Joe Rogan.
Okay, goodbye, Dad.
Okay, all right. Bye. See you.